Hey guys, what's happening? Thanks for tuning in, coming back and watching. I appreciate it. Hope your day's going really well. I am in Topaz Studio 2 today, and I'm playing around with some creative, artistic filters, and this video is what I consider the three most artistic or creative filters in Topaz Studio. So let's jump into it. Okay, I've got this image here, which I shot in Italy, and one of the things I like to do, as you know, if you've watched any of my videos, that is, you know, I like to edit photos and just do different things. And most of the time I keep them, you know, within the bounds of reality. In other words, I don't turn them into abstractions, if you will. And that was a hint about the first filter. But there are times when I like to create kind of a digital painting, and there's no better app for doing that than Topaz Studio, because it incorporates things like what used to be known as Topaz Simplify and Topaz Impression, Topaz Glow, and all these kind of tools. So a lot of great art tools in there. So as I said, the first filter is abstraction. It's down here in the stylistic category. I'm gonna go ahead and grab that and put it on the photo. Now, there's a number of different things that you can do in each of the filters that I'm talking about, and this will not be an exhaustive view or tutorial, if you will, about every aspect of each of these filters. I just wanna show you kind of how they operate and what they do, and then show you how I use them on a photo. So in this case, to me, abstraction is basically what used to be known as Topaz Simplify, which was a standalone app back in the day. Simplify size, that's kind of the amount slider, for lack of a better word, and you just drag it to the right. And the further to the right you get, the more simple it gets. And so, as the name implies, it simplifies, or as the name of the filter implies, it abstracts detail. It basically removes detail, and it doesn't smooth out the photo in the sense of like a denoise filter does, but it does remove those edges and takes it from, you know, a photo to where you look like, depending on how far you go, it can start to look like a drawing. And you can even create kind of a line type pencil drawing out of these if you wanted to. I generally don't go that heavy. I like to kind of be kind of bordering on the edge of reality a little bit. So maybe something about like that, maybe a little bit more. And usually what I would do is go in and add other filters on top of this. I'd go probably get some contrast, some basic adjustment, maybe some quad tone, things like that to play around with the colors and the tones. Within the filter here, you can of course boost features if you want to, which brings back some of the harder edges. So you still have the kind of the simplified look, but you have some features that are kind of returned, but not to the point of it being back to being a photo. If you can kind of see in the example, better than I can explain it. Details, you can basically enhance the details, so it does start to get a little bit crisper, if you will, the further you go to the right. But you, again, you still have that simplify thing kind of going on, so it still looks like it's a type of drawing or something. As I take simplify to the right and detail to the right, it becomes like a really crispy, fine detailed drawing. Not really a look that I typically go for, but that is how the filter works. And then you've got detail boost and detail radius. Detail radius, let me pull up the details a little bit. The detail radius, if you drag that to the right, you can see that, let me boost the details a bit so you can see that better. So let me return this to zero. So there is a detail radius at zero. As I drag that to the right, it's getting a whole lot crispier. It looks like a really bad HDR. The nice thing is, as you go to the left, it kind of softens that up. So, you know, again, you can play around. There are some presets here, but generally speaking, I'll take simplify size and pull it over here to just enough to abstract some of the detail, maybe something like that. I don't want to totally lose touch with reality, but then I'll go and add other filters and enhance the photo from there. So that's filter number one, abstraction. Filter number two, I'm just going to use the same photo, is impression. And as the name implies, it allows you to create impressionist type painting looks to your photos, as you can see here, as well as a lot of other kind of looks. And in my mind, this is basically the tool that used to be known as Topaz Impression. Again, all incorporated in Topaz Studio 2. One price for, I think it's $99, you get Topaz Studio 2, and you get all the filters that are built into it. So this filter list here, every one of these filters comes with the product for one price. Anyway, with Topaz Impression, or the Impression filter, I should say, you've got different brushstroke patterns or brushstroke types you can go and use. You can see you've got several there. And then you've got a lot of different options down here in terms of how you want to customize the look of it. And there's a whole lot here. Again, not a detailed tutorial, but the nice thing about it is at the very bottom, if you scroll down, you also have this section that's basically an HSL filter built within Topaz Impression, or the Impression filter. And I like that because I would often go get HSL anyway to amplify colors. So color is in there. On top of that, you have lighting. And so if you scroll down and look at this, brightness, contrast, highlights, shadows, you can also pick a vignette and pick the position the light is coming from. So again, a lot of customization ability. I think that's really cool. And of course, the last piece is texture. Now, do not confuse this with the texture filter, which is a separate filter also in the stylistic category here. The texture filter itself has a whole lot of textures built in. The textures built into the impression filter are limited to basically just textures that you would see in a canvas if you were, in fact, painting on a canvas, which makes a lot of sense if you think about it. So these are all kind of textured canvas type looks, something that you would normally see kind of as a canvas type to paint on, if you will. But that's how impression works. You can go in and customize it a lot. I will admit what I often will do is go to add look, and I've already got it here on impression. I'll just do the drop down. Not radiance. I'll go and grab impression, and I'll pick a category, and I'll usually do artistic, and then I scroll down, and two that I really like are at the bottom, Van Gogh and watercolor 2. With one click, you can just say apply, and it'll stick that onto your photo, apply the look, and then of course, if you wanted to, you can just adjust the opacity to reduce that intensity a little bit if you like it, but don't want it as intense as it comes out at 100, right? You can just reduce that. So that's a way you can do those kind of things. And that's often how I'll go about using some of these filters, is just go into the looks category, grab a look that's in that uses that filter and apply it. So that's two, that's abstraction and impression. And the third one, and this is kind of the wild card, this is smudge. Smudge allows you, as the name implies, to really smudge the lines in the photo. So the best thing to do is just show you that. And if you look at that, you can kind of see what it's doing. It's very evident over here. Let me just zoom in a little bit, right? Whoa, you can see what it's doing there. It's really, you can see the before and the after. It's really creating a lot of smudge, I guess, in those lines. But here's what I like about the filter. If you look at the water before and after, the water is starting to take on, I think, a really interesting look. And so what I will normally do is take this photo, this filter, not abstraction, smudge, drag it, you know, somewhere maybe about like that, maybe halfway or so, and then just remove it from the rest of the photo and just leave it in the water. And that allows me to create a little bit of a long exposure kind of look in the water. So it works particularly well on streams and creeks, maybe waterfalls, anywhere, rivers is a good one, anywhere where the water is kind of in motion. This is a harbor, so it's actually probably not ideal because you're not expecting a lot of movement in the water. But regardless, like if you look at the original, let me zoom back in. I don't really like the look of water like that, which is basically just, hey, I got a snapshot and there's the water. It's a tiny bit choppy. It's a little too busy for me visually. That's why I like long exposures. It, no pun intended, it simplifies water. And I've done long exposures with moving objects like these boats. And in fact, I've got a long exposure somewhere that I took in this scene at night. It came out really good. Of course, the boats are in motion quite a bit, but still it looks pretty good. But I'm getting off topic. The key here is that I think that, especially when you're backed out a little bit, creates a little bit better look in the water than the original. Personal opinion, but that's why I consider smudge one of the three best artistic or creative filters. And what I want to do now is take this photo. I'm going to get everything set. I've already got the photo built. And so let me go get that and load it up, and I'll walk you through my workflow for how I use those filters to edit this photo. Okay, here's the original, and here's my final painted version. It's just adjusted to my sensibilities, if you will, which is artistic looking and very colorful. I'm going to reset these filters and then walk through that. Okay, here you go. Now, as you can tell in the filter list on the right, I actually used all three of the filters that I talked about to create this final image. So I started with abstraction, and as you can see here, I took simplify size to 35, didn't really do anything else, and took the opacity to about 51. So I went from that to that. So I did abstract the detail, but only a slight bit. And that is because the next filter I used was impression, where I wanted to go in and apply a bit of a painterly look, but I felt like applying impression heavily on top of abstraction, if I'd applied that heavily, was getting really too far into the realm of art. Now, I already know this is an art piece, and so you know, it's not like I'm trying to say this is photorealistic. It's clearly a, you know, a digital painting, if you will. But regardless, I chose the first brush that comes up there. Whoa, I'm just dragging the whole app here. There we go. You can see I took the brush size up a little bit and the paint volume up, and I didn't really do anything else. I don't think I did anything down here. No, I left color alone, and I left lighting alone, I think. Yeah. And I know for sure I didn't use a texture. So a very simple approach there, just a couple of little sliders, but I feel like it added to the photo. There's the before, which is just abstraction, and there it is with abstraction plus impression. So I am stacking these filters, and of course the next one to stack is smudge. So in this case, I went to 87, so fairly high. And then as you can see, I masked it in, or technically I masked it out of everything except the water. So in other words, I just really wanted to apply that to the water. So I just used the brush, applied it to the water, and I feel like that gave me a nice little bit of movement in the water. So if you look over here, and let me zoom a little bit. There we go, something like that. Let me show you the before. There's the before smudge, and there's the after. It just gives it a little bit of flow, and I kind of like that look. Again, I didn't mask super cleanly around the motors. I recommend if you're doing things like that, you might want to do a little bit more careful job. But truthfully, it's a digital painting, so it's not going to be photorealistic or detailed anyway. The other thing, there were a couple of buoys in the water. There was one there, which is just blurry now, and there was one there. You may want to consider, not original, I want to go to fit. You may want to consider erasing things like that before you get into doing these kind of edits, but it's just an idea. They're honestly so small, being so smudged out, that you can hardly tell, so I just left them. Next up was precision contrast, and this is where I've already stacked all three of these art filters, and now I'm just creating a bit more, I'm just making my painting look the way I want my painting to look, I guess. So precision contrast, I just bumped it up in the micro, low, and medium categories. Nothing significant there, nothing unique, or certainly nothing difficult, but it was lacking contrast before. You can see it's painterly and it has some color, but it's very flat. There's no tonal differences between the highlights and shadows. And so this contrast really gives it, I think, a nice little bit of kick, a little bit of pop. And you will notice that the colors start to pop more when you add contrast, and that's a thing to be aware of. So another reason I like precision contrast so much, which did show up in that previous video that I did about the five most useful or five best filters in Topaz Studio. Next up was a basic adjustment. And as you can see there, I did a little bit of color work. I just took the saturation up a fairly significant amount, 45. I took temperature left and tint to the right. Those are things I typically do in the paintings that I create in studio, which is play with the saturation, I play with temperature, and I play with tint. Because again, I started with this photo and I liked it. In fact, I think it's beautiful like that. And Italy just begs to be painted anyway. I liked it, but I was like, if I'm making a painting, I definitely want to amp up the colors a bit. So I added in the basic adjustment, popped that a little bit. And the last thing I did was go and get HSL color tuning. And all I did is I took the blue and reduced the saturation just here, like in the boats, because let me show you the before and after. If you look at these two boats, the blue's really bleeding all the way across the boats. And the truth is the boats were white to begin with, and I just wanted to return them to white. I also feel like, let me show you the original, right? So white boat there and there. I think it looks better. I also feel like having that white in the foreground really anchors the photo. When it's more blue, it's kind of getting lost, and I feel like your eye is kind of going everywhere. I feel like now my eye is kind of drawn to that boat, and it might lead up the row of boats to that distant building on the right and then across the left. And I'm trying to draw the viewer's eye. And so having that pop of white I think is really eye-catching in this case, kind of like red. So I feel like it works pretty well to sort of draw the viewer into the frame. And that's really it. So that's a few different steps with the three filters that I consider really the most creative or artistic filters in Topaz Studio 2 and how I like to use them, which is in fact stacking them. I have historically thought like, all right, if you're gonna simplify or abstract, use that filter, that's a thing and you do it on a photo. If you wanna go impression, you do that on a photo, and smudge is totally something else, but I actually think they work really well in tandem. So once again, there's my final result. And I hope it helps, my friends. Just a workflow video on how I use these filters in Studio. And thanks for watching. I do appreciate it. I hope you're having a super awesome day. Love for you to like the video. Leave a comment. Let me know what you think about these kind of videos. And share with your friends, that sort of thing. And I'll see you soon, friends. Got more videos coming. Have a great day. Take care and adios.